We read the documentation so you don't have to, and this is what we learned. Number 1, an easy trail. You can make a trail in a very easy way. Just use a line 2D and add a point to it in every physics frame. If you want your trail to be limited, remove points when a certain number of points is reached or it got too long. With a scale curve, this looks really cool. Related to this, if you want to have a node with a transform independent of their parent, use set as top level. It then acts as if it was a direct child of the scene root, and therefore its position is its global position. That way, we can add a trail as a child of a node.
Number 2. Helps to have a map. Organizing your project can be a hassle, but L4V05 showed us a great solution. With this neat plugin called Project Map, you can organize your assets in a map and group your nodes. This can drastically reduce the time you waste searching that one script. Just drag files from the file system panel onto the map. To open the file, you can click on the node name. You can simply download this plugin from GitHub or install it via the asset library. Enable it in your project and you get this tab on the top to open the project map.
Number 3. How can you even interpolate methods? Tweens can actually interpolate methods, not just properties. Simply use interpolate method with the node, the method name, starting value, target value and duration. The method will be called every frame with the interpolated values. You can do very complex stuff with that, like adding points to a line by interpolating from the start to end position. It is also super helpful whenever you want to react to a property change.
Number 4. Inconstant constants. In GDScript, you can declare variables as const. This has a large advantage. They do not need to be stored multiple times for multiple instances of the class. The most common usage of const is for a preload, because preloads are expensive and do not change. The name const for constant implies that these variables cannot change. And this is true for primitive types like ints. But for objects, not changing just refers to their identity, not their state. So you can declare a const string, color or array and still change it. It will be shared between all nodes. I still would not advise doing that.
Number 5. Preload database. If you ever find yourself preloading the same scene in multiple scripts, it gets really tedious to update all of them when the path changes. An easy fix is brought by scaroots. Just put all of them in a data class where you reference them from. You can make it a node, so you can put it into your project's autoloads and access it from everywhere in your code.
Number 6. Fake 3D and diagonal squishing. If you have a 2D node, such as a sprite, you can scale it in X and Y direction, but you cannot squish it sideways for sharing. If you want this, you can use a vertex shader. We explained that here. But you can also put another node 2D above and scale that one in the Y direction. You can see the sprite is now squished diagonally. If you rotate the child node, you have this kind of pseudo 3D effect that looks pretty cool.
Number 7. Check your performance. Most code is not performance critical at all, and you should not bother optimizing it. But some code is. To find out what code that is for your project, you can use the profiler. Just go to Debugger, Profiler on the bottom when you play. You can see which functions take how long. You can add and remove specific functions to the plot to see which ones contribute to a spike. In this particular example, you can see that instantiating becomes more and more expensive as the scene tree is filled with sprites, while the loop's cost is identical in every frame.
Number 8. Engine shortcuts. When working with Godot, you tend to switch very often from the 2D or 3D editor to the script editor. And every second saved there is a bit of extra productivity. You can switch faster than clicking using keyboard shortcuts. The standard shortcut is Ctrl plus F1, F2 or F3 depending on the tab. But you can change it like Marbles did. For example to Alt plus Q, W and E. Just go to Editor, Editor Settings, Shortcuts and search for Open. By the way, we discovered this stuff by working on our own game, Furcifer's Fungeon, a roguelike where we draw everything that hurts you on the ground so we can throw randomized death at you. Go to the description, click the link and wishlist that thing. Give this video a like, subscribe, share it with your grandma while you're at it, and sell us your soul.
Number 9. Iterate everything. If you have a custom class that you want to iterate, you can do this, but you have to implement the necessary functions. These are iterinit, iternext and iterget. This is most interesting if you implement some kind of container, like a 2D array or maybe a dialog script. Usually, you keep an index to the current element within the class. In iterinit, you reset that index to the first element. In iter next, you advance the index to the next element and check if you have reached the end of your data structure. You need to return the result of that check. In iter get, you just return the value at the current index. Now you can just create an instance of your iteratable class and iterate it with a for loop.
Number 10. Animation player tricks. The animation player has a lot of cool features hidden inside, as Darkpiece pointed out. You can select multiple keyframes, go to Edit Duplicate Selection and duplicate the selected part of the animation. As a shortcut, use Ctrl D. And down there you have two helpful buttons I always ignored. This little funnel there hides all tracks except the ones referring to the node you currently select in the scene tree. Really nice if you have many tracks. And the list icon right next to it removes the grouping, which makes the list much shorter if you have many different nodes. So we hope some of these were helpful. Let us know your tricks. If you want to watch more of this, here are 10 more tricks, and here are games made with Godot.